What can we do to reverse global warming? Become aware of the solutions and think about the actions you can take as you listen to How We Are Drawing Down in Pennsylvania. The first sector featured in the book Drawdown, the most comprehensive plan ever proposed to reverse global warming, is the electricity generation sector. And its section starts with a powerful statement. We are squarely in the middle of the greatest energy transition in history. The era of fossil fuels is over. And the only question now is to when the new era will be fully upon us. Solar, wind, wave and tidal, and geothermal are now economically competitive renewable energy sources. Solutions such as biomass and methane digesters are excellent additions to the electricity generation portfolio, and their contributions are needed, as the power sector currently accounts for around 40% of annual greenhouse gas emissions to the atmosphere, making it the highest emitting sector. Over the past 25 years, the work addressing climate change, greenhouse gas emission reductions, and renewable energy has certainly changed, as explained by Mr. Mark Hammond, environmental attorney at Land, Air, Water Legal Solutions, LLC.
25 years ago, we really focused on traditional, also called criteria air pollutants. So acid rain was still a big problem. Greenhouse gas emissions really wasn't a word that anybody was familiar with because nobody really thought about climate change. The science hadn't developed to this point where it is today and people understood that there was an emerging problem. So when I did work 25 years ago, it was about NOx emissions. It was about mercury emissions and lead emissions. It was about acid rain. Today, most of those problems are solved or well on their way to being solving. So today we think about things like greenhouse gases, and we think about how do we make electricity cleaner. 25 years ago, we thought about how do we make enough electricity? How do we have domestic energy security? Today, we don't worry about energy domestic security because we essentially have lots of energy here. We worry about how to make it cleaner, not how to make it at all.
For the state of Pennsylvania, it has seen a transition in its own energy sector for an even longer period of time. Yet, with energy always being an important resource for the state, Dr. Tom Richard, professor of agricultural and biological engineering and director of the Institutes of Energy and the Environment at Penn State University, here to explain the various energy sources in Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania has a lot of electricity generation, and that includes a really diverse portfolio. But that portfolio has changed a lot in the last few decades. First of all, really starting more than 50 years ago, we have a significant amount of electricity generation that's nuclear power, and that's really low carbon energy. It's helped for all those decades to reduce the carbon footprint of electricity generation in our state. We've historically had most of our electricity from coal. Again, that resource is one that's very abundant in our state and region and has been historically the lowest cost approach to electricity generation. But that coal is becoming a smaller and smaller part of our portfolio. In fact, in just the last 5 years, it switched from being the biggest component to now number three. And the most common source of electricity generation in Pennsylvania today is natural gas, primarily from the Marcellus Shale Formation, which really is a new resource. The shale gas technology, hydraulic fracturing and directional drilling, is something that has really expanded dramatically just in the last 7 to 8 years. And now that natural gas component of our electricity generation is more than twice as big as coal and is almost half. So right now, almost half is natural gas. Nuclear power is number two and coal is number three. But those are followed by several renewable sources. We do have quite a bit of biomass energy here in Pennsylvania, and that is our number four resource, our largest renewable resource right now.
Additional renewable energy sources are present in Pennsylvania, but not always as abundant.
We do have wind and solar. Those are relatively small at this point, but growing rapidly. And we've just put some new policies in place in the last few years that are increasing, particularly the solar implementation. And we also have hydroelectric power, including, interestingly, hydroelectric power that's being used as energy storage. So there's something called pumped hydro, which is an approach of using excess electricity during non-peak demand periods and using that energy to pump water uphill into a reservoir where it can then run back downhill through a set of hydroelectric turbines during peak demand periods. And Pennsylvania has a dam that's built many decades ago down in the lower Susquehanna that's set up for that pumped hydro system. And in fact, at the time it was built, it was the largest pumped hydro technology in the world.
Despite Pennsylvania's work towards renewables, there's still work required to be able to reach drawdown.
So we have a nice suite of diversity of energy supplies. That increase in natural gas has significantly reduced the carbon footprint of Pennsylvania electricity as it's substituted for coal, but neither coal nor natural gas, as they're currently implemented, are achieving the kinds of CO2 emission reductions that are necessary for us to meet our climate goals and targets. So we're really looking hard at how we can either reduce the carbon emissions from those electricity sources through things like carbon capture and storage, which in the drawdown framework is really a coming attraction because it's not implemented at scale in a practical way yet. But also through looking at significant growth of the renewables portfolio, thinking really hard about the nuclear energy portfolio, which is struggling in terms of its economics right now. And so there's some serious questions about whether the existing significant, remember that's the number two supply of electricity in Pennsylvania today, whether that can continue to be a major contributor, and whether there's some new lower cost and approaches that can be built to help to, again, bring on lots of low carbon electricity. So we have a portfolio approach. It's fairly diverse and it's changing rapidly. And while it's hard to predict the future, there have been significant reductions in our carbon emissions per unit of electricity produced by Pennsylvania over the last decade. And we expect that to continue.
Predictions for how the growth will progress for renewable energy in the state of Pennsylvania is a challenge, as Dr. Richard explains.
It's really quite difficult to predict the growth of renewables. But one interesting fact is that those predictions that have been made for solar in particular, which is right now the fastest growing component of the renewables portfolio on a percentage basis, not yet in terms of installed capacity, because the wind sector is still growing a little bit faster than that in Pennsylvania. But that may change very quickly. And the estimates by the Energy Information Agency over the last more than a decade have consistently, significantly underestimated the implementation of solar. Every year they predict that it's not going to grow all that much, and most years it grows a lot. So for example, several years in the last decade where we've had 20, 30, even as much as a 50% increase in our installed capacity of solar in a single year. And that's called exponential growth. And although it's starting from a relatively small base, a couple of percent right now in Pennsylvania, it has the potential to grow rapidly if that kind of exponential growth continues.
Pennsylvania is showing its commitment to solar energy through various programs and reports, as reported by Marie Cusick, reporter for State Impact Pennsylvania.
They also put out a report at the end of last year called finding Pennsylvania's solar future. So right now, under current law, Pennsylvania is required to produce about 0.5% of its electricity from solar sources by 2021. We are on track to do that, but when that law passed in 2004, it was seen as quite ambitious. But of course, since time has passed, other states have set much more aggressive renewable energy targets. So this new report they put out late last year, it sets a much more ambitious goal to try to get 10% of Pennsylvania's electricity from solar sources by 2030. We've also seen leadership coming at, you know, the city level. Philadelphia has been doing a lot of things. They have a program called Solarize Philly, where they're trying to get more panels on low and moderate income families, which it includes a job training component for students to learn how to become solar panel installers. And Philly is also working to build a pretty big solar farm in Adams County, Pennsylvania. It will be a 70 megawatt facility that will help produce about 22% of the power needed for Philadelphia's government buildings by 2020. So certainly we are seeing things happening and people are interested in talking about growing renewable generation, and there are projects in the works.
As with any technology, there's a cost. And when it comes to using renewable electricity to reach drawdown, Dr. Richard breaks down these costs for the state of Pennsylvania.
So the main drivers for renewable electricity expansion are associated with cost. And the costs of wind and especially solar have been dropping really dramatically over the last decade. And solar is now proving to be cost competitive with several of the traditional energy resources in many parts of the country. Now, Pennsylvania is not the sunniest state in our union. And so here it's been a little bit lagging in terms of its cost competitiveness, but the newest technologies are actually cost effective here. And Penn State ourselves has just invested in what's called a power purchase agreement with a private sector partner for getting 25% of our electricity from solar. And in that agreement, we are actually going to be saving money over our conventional electricity supplier. So that's a difference this year that wasn't the case 2 or 3 years ago. And as that lower cost continues, we may well see a very rapid transition to solar. However, I think we need to continue to think about a diverse portfolio. One of the things that's not typically built into the cost of solar energy is its intermittency and the fact that the sun's not shining at night. So we need to be storing a lot of electricity for that period, and battery storage is quite expensive. That's one of the reasons that we're looking at alternative storage techniques, especially very large-scale storage, such as the pumped hydro that I mentioned previously. But it's also a reason to invest heavily in understanding and improving battery technology at every scale, from the batteries that we're carrying around in our phones and calculators and all of our other electronic devices, but also what's called grid-scale battery storage.
Dr. Richard calls attention to one final point, energy efficiency, a source of electricity that people don't think about very often.
One of the hidden sources of electricity is energy efficiency. And interestingly, at a national level, that energy efficiency that we've managed to implement over the last 40 to 50 years is now over 1/3 of our total energy supply. So if we were to project forward from 1980, what was the energy efficiency of our different technologies then, we would be using at least 50% more electricity now than we do. And that difference is not only zero carbon electricity, but it's also the cheapest electricity that we could generate. Energy efficiency is far lower cost than purchasing electricity. And that's everything from more efficient vehicles with higher miles per gallon, more efficient electricity generation systems, including our gas turbines, more efficient buildings. And this is really our largest single carbon footprint. Buildings use 70% of electricity and are responsible for 40% of greenhouse gas emissions worldwide. And I think those levels are perhaps even higher here in Pennsylvania. So energy efficiency in buildings is a great way to drive down both costs of buildings, and that efficiency is cost effective, whether it's high efficiency windows or increased insulation, more efficient heating plants, all sorts of things we can do in terms of our design and maintenance of buildings. And it's also a way to make our buildings more livable and comfortable with better health outcomes, and some evidence is also better performance outcomes. So there's a lot of interest from the commercial sector in thinking about how they can make increased worker productivity. And one of the ways to do that is with a high efficiency building.
To conclude, the U.S. Energy Information Administration reports that Pennsylvania's gross natural gas production, primarily from the Marcellus Shale, was the second largest in the nation after Texas. In 2017, Pennsylvania was the third largest coal-producing state in the nation and ranked second in the nation in electricity generation from nuclear power, which supplied 42% of the state's net electricity generation, more than from any other energy source. Clearly, Pennsylvania is a very important state in terms of energy. But Pennsylvania is a state in transition, a transition to greater use of renewable sources for electricity generation. Pennsylvania requires that 18% of the electricity sold by 2021 come from renewable sources, including at least 0.5% solar photovoltaic power. In 2017, renewable energy accounted for 4.5% of the state's net electricity generation. And this value will continue to grow, allowing Pennsylvania to get closer and closer to the goal of reaching drawdown with reversing its greenhouse gas emissions. Thanks for listening. This is Anna from Penn State Brandywine.